So you want to improve at Vanguard?
I realized that all it takes to do a standing video is just angle up my camera and my lights, and suddenly I can move around freely in this room. Oh my god, it feels great. Welcome everyone to today's video, in which we are going to talk about 5 tips on how you can improve at Vanguard. Now, I've wanted to make a video like this for quite a while, and for quite some time I thought that maybe I'm not really skilled enough to tell you this, but I feel like over this last year I've been able to compete quite well and prove to show some pretty good results overall as well, and even when, you know, not getting tops due to team tournaments, still managing to go with a good record on my own. And of course, throughout this year I've applied different kinds of lessons that I've learned and different kinds of methods and approaches in order to improve, and I thought I would share them with you in this video as well. Especially because BCS season is approaching for you guys, I know a lot of you are going to be chasing for that World Invitation. I think this is a good time to actually take a look and reflect on maybe some things that I'm sure most of you are doing when you're preparing for competitive events or how you're analyzing your plays, but also just some things that might be good for some of the beginner players to advance their gameplay as well. Some of these may seem a little bit obvious to some of the more advanced players, but I hope that even for the advanced players, there's still something to take away from here. But to begin with, my first tip is actually to make sure that you are respecting your win con at all times. And this is something that I've talked about before, but respecting your win con doesn't just mean like, oh, I need to make sure that I don't misplay when I'm about to win and have lethal or chase lethal, but it's more so about how do you actually approach your game plan from turn one all the way to the final turn in order to reach your end game, in order to reach your win con. So are you playing something that's more of an aggro deck like Roroa, which actually needs to push early turns because it cannot survive into the late game in order to win by turn 4? And how are you creating your boards in order to force your opponent to take damage so that the actual, you know, the attacks actually hit and your opponent's not just dropping, you know, 5k guards in order to block your swings, and then that way your game plan crumbles apart? Are you playing a deck like Gandiva or Eva that can kind of freeze your opponent at 3 or 4 and then just basically just threaten with crits to win so that your opponent doesn't have the resources to play? Do you win through raw compression such as with Lista or Eva right now, where playing the long game is in your best interest, so you have to both build your deck as well as plan your game plan in a way that you get to compress all the way to the late game and win through just checking triggers and winning? I also invite you to think about what damage does your opponent need to be on for you to secure lethal, right? For a lot of decks, you know, that rely on multi-attacks, like let's say Maelstrom, that'll be 5, right? You want your opponent to be at 5 so don't get shut down by defensive. Minerva in the current format as well is very much like that, where your opponent's at 5, chances are they're not going to shut down any of your attacks, and therefore they're going to eat up to 8 attacks in one turn, and that way you can secure the win. But some decks that have the crit pressure can kind of freeze your opponent at 3 or 4, and that way you can secure lethal all the way from 4. So again, giving the example of Eva, you can blue research into a grade 3 obscurade, swing with a 2 crit first, force them to guard, swing with Vanguard with a compressed deck where they know that you're risking to lose if you take it, and then you call another 2 crit obscurate, and then if you check a crit, you can put another crit in the other rear guard, and that way you have 4 lethal swings in one turn from 4 damage, and you don't need your opponent to be on 5 at all. Now, sometimes your win con isn't very conventional. Sometimes it's decking your opponent out, and especially when it comes to playing late game decks like Gandiva versus Willista, for example, that is where you might have to think about, okay, how am I going to efficiently deck them out? And this whole time, you shouldn't just be thinking about what you want to do with your win con, but also what your opponent wants to do as well. If you're playing against Willista and you have ways to disrupt their board, maybe, you know, targeting Elvira instead of something like a Yuika is going to be huge, because if you remove their Elviras, chances are that their draw engine is going to shut down and you can win the long game by just not letting them draw as many cards. So I want you to always think about both yours and your opponent's win con and how that interacts and what you can do to make your opponent get farther away from their win con and how you can get closer to yours by advancing your game plan throughout the entire game. Another one is forcing awkward guarding. Now, this is by far the most important one in my opinion, simply because, I mean, honestly, all of these are very important, but forcing awkward guarding comes back to magic numbers, right? This discussion always comes back to magic numbers because magic numbers are what dictate how you win in this game. Because in the end, in Vanguard, your hand is basically your HP bar, right? Of course, you lose at 6 damage, but what determines how quickly you lose or how quickly you win is basically how much attack power and shield power you have in your hand. So you always fight with your hand. It's your resource system. It is what you are going to defend yourself with and also attack with. And by forcing awkward guarding from your opponent, that means that you are both dwindling their defenses and potentially forcing them to discard essential combo pieces that are helping them push their game plan instead. So of course, you know, when you're attacking, you're making your attack numbers in the current standard format, there's quite a few ways to add a plus 5k power adjustment. And for example, in Willista, you have things like Yuika, in Gandiva especially, that 2k increment can really change a lot. And so instead of attacking for 23, which is a 1 card guard, you can attack for 28, which of course is going to ask for a front trigger or 2 card guard, and then 33 invites a must 2 card Guard Guard no matter what, unless they're playing like the Blitz Regulus piece for 25k shield or something. So you should always think about these awkward numbers to force your opponent to guard in ways that aren't very convenient for them. And sometimes attacking with low numbers, especially if your opponent's at high damage, can also help, because if everything is 5k guard, that means your opponent doesn't want to drop their triggers to guard because they're guarding for too much, and they'll be invited to actually guard with their combo pieces, and that is also very important. And speaking of those, there's actually another point, which is that one thing that changed with magic numbers in the D series is that before the D series, we could tell players like, yeah, attack with lowest to highest because, you know, because of defensive triggers and stuff like that. But now, because of the way that perfect guards work, in that you can guard with them with just one card without discarding when you're at low enough hand, sometimes let's say you have two attacks, one of them is a higher power and the other one is a lower power. And let's say your opponent's hand is three cards in hand, two 15k shields, and one perfect guard. So let's say your lower attack can be blocked with 30k shield and the higher attack has to be PG'd. So if you attack with lower to higher, what's going to happen is you attack with lower, your opponent drops two 15k shield, you attack with a higher, your opponent drops the PG without having to discard, end of story. Whereas if you went the other way around, you attack with the higher first, force them to PG by discarding one of the 15k shields, and then you attack with the lower, where the 15k shield they have left in hand is not enough. So things like that are very important. Track your opponent's perfect guards, how many they have, because this will sometimes actually change the game very heavily, and so you always have to think about that. Now the next one is one that I think is often not mentioned enough, and this is what I notice, like, less experienced players kind of mess up the most, which is compression and sequencing. So compression is basically removing cards from your deck that are not triggers in Vanguard for the most part, but it's also sometimes compressing in order to make sure that when you use effects and look at the top X cards of the deck, you are more likely to hit the thing that you want. Sequencing refers to how you sequence your effects in order to lead to the most optimal case scenario. Now, optimal case can mean drawing the most cards or hitting the best targets from a search, but it can also mean having the most amount of power and best ways for your opponent to guard awkwardly in Vanguard as well. For this one, let's take a look at some examples. All right, let's begin the examples, and what better way to start talking about compression as well as sequencing than with Eva, the queen of compression. So let's say we are entering our turn four here, and we have our three research orders in the order zone. Let's say we have some amount of damage. Don't worry about it too much, but what is going to be important here is immediately after the ride phase. Let's see, this is our hand. We have a persona ride as well as the blue research lab as well as the habitable zone. So we're going to persona ride here and draw a card from it. And now I ask you viewers a question, which of these two do you use first? Blue research lab lets you find a card from the top five and call it, whereas habitable zone searches for an order, lets you set a second order this turn, and the next order you set is free. Now the goal this turn is to set up a dock together with a blue research lab, and optimally from the blue research lab find an obscedate to help us push game with. Of course, we're going to be doing stuff with Eva afterwards as well in order to push the game plan even further beyond, but what I want you to choose is one or two. I'll give you a second to think about it. Do we play this first to call something, or do we play the habitable zone to compress and then call something after that? The correct answer is, if your objective is to find obscedate, is to play this first, because you want to play the habitable zone and CB1 here in order to find yourself an order. So if you play dock, you find dock. If you don't, you find something else. The reason why is because by compressing the deck by one card, you are raising your chance to find the obscedate here. And so now we can use habitable's skill to first set this for free and draw a card from the onset effect too. So we draw a draw trigger. And now we want to set the blue research lab and look at the top five. And even if we don't find the obscedate here, the sequencing itself has helped you arrive at that goal. So let's check top five. And we do have an obscedate, right? So this is basically, you know, one of the paths to help you compress correctly. And then afterwards, of course, you can still use Eva's effect to find a card off the top, countercharge with the experiment henceforth, etc. If you had done it the other way around, you would have called the card first and maybe, you know, would have found one of the orders that we searched as one of the top fives, which just bloats the top five that you're searching for. So sequencing like this and compressing is going to help a lot. All right, so this next example is going to be with Willista. And I think there's a pretty important sequencing thing to think about when you play Willista, which will help us to question which way is the right way. So in Willista, typically on turn two, you put the gem order into the soul, which has two effects, which is one, when you play it, you draw a card, put it to soul, and give the Vanguard plus 5k and the rearguard restand skill. But the second one is when the grade 3 Ballista Soul Blasts it, you get to look at top 5 and call 2. And so the way that you sequence this is really important, because on turn 2, you always play the gem and it goes to your soul because, you know, because that's what the deck does, and you get the plus 5k on the grade 2. And the next turn, let's say this is our hand, right? And we have the gem in the drop, for example. Let's say we drop the cycle card for the write-up into Willista, so we'll simply write up into her. And then here, of course, you get to use Willista's on-write effect, or you can use the cycle card in order to draw one from this, or you can use the Willista in order to get the gem back. So here what we'll do is we can just use the cycle card. This sequencing isn't as important, but it's important that you don't soul blast your gem here, because let's say if you do soul blast the gem, that means that now you are forced to first play the gem again, which puts itself to soul, and only then you get to soul blast in order to call two. But here, want to soul blast anything other than the gem in order to put the Vouch Brown to the bottom of the deck and then draw ourselves an extra card. And then we can just discard one for Willista's effect in order to get the gem back to hand. Now, what's important about the sequencing I'm going to show you now is that if you don't have the gem in soul, you cannot use Willista's effect to look at top five and call two. But the gem, of course, it is a draw one immediately, but it only gets better if you have more Elviras on the field, for example. So instead, we want to first use the Willista skill to soul blast the gem and look at the top five in order to call two and try to find more Elviras. And there we go. We find ourselves two Elvira. Here, of course, you can, of course, look at your hand, what you have. If you have Elviras in hand, is a different story. But just from calling these two first and then shuffling, you now get to play the gem and draw three cards. Whereas if you played it first, you would only draw one. So drawing three here is much more powerful because this will get you more cards to play with for your next turns. All right, and this last example will be the classic Jet. So of course, Jet sequencing is super important in order to bring out the highest power from the crest. And so here we invite you to solve this situation. We have only one soul here in this Jet, and we have to, of course, set up more soul in order to be able to use Gigi at some point in this turn, you know, to draw more cards. And we're also playing the new card, Crucial Dragon from Festival Booster, who allows you, when he attacks, if you don't boost him, to put a rearguard into the soul in order to get plus 5k and retire an opponent's rearguard. So now, if you're thinking about maximizing power and also ending up at using at least one GG this turn, what is the optimal case scenario? Now, you might be tempted to think, okay, we have only one soul, so of course I could swing with this boosted, and then the Sargon, of course, if it hits, it can put two cards from the drop into the soul, but that means this has to hit, and without any crest power-ups, this is only swinging for 21. So if, let's say, you attack with it and use the skill, you would immediately have the two soul and retire rearguard. But the problem is that then when you attack with the Fate Rider, you would have to time leap this after turning it into a grade zero into a one, which isn't exactly pushing for big numbers. Alternatively, if you're attacking with this second and then calling a grade one, you're basically losing out on 5k increments from the crest as well, so that's not good either. So let's turn back time a little bit. Here you can use the fact that Sargon gives red text, and what red text means is that it's a skill that the Vanguard inherits, or the thing that it boosts inherits, even if the unit itself disappears. So here what you can do is you can swing with the upstream with the 15k power and then basically return it in order to search your deck for a copy of Sargon and call it behind the Vanguard. Then we give our deck a good shuffle, and after that, we can actually swing with the Vanguard immediately in order to attack and boost the Fate Rider, and then this effect will be inherited by the Fate Rider in order to, when you hit, get two cards from your drop zone into your soul. And then you can use Fate Rider's effect in order to counterblast one, flip a card in your G-zone face up for the crest, and target this Sargon in order to put it back to deck and turn it into a grade two. So now, if the Fate Rider hits, you are also getting the soul charge too, even though the Sargon isn't on the field anymore. And that is very important because we are able to essentially push through here with the additional plus 5k and still have the on-hit pressure. And then, of course, you know, we'll do our drive check and, you know, find some cards. Let's we find a draw trigger, draw into RT, of course. But let's say, if even if this didn't hit, right, let's say our opponent perfect guarded, we can now afford to, with the extra 5k increment, swing with the dragon, put this into the soul to get our second soul while retiring opponent's rearguard. I apologize for the glare here. And now we can still use upstream and then leap it into a grade one and finish on a GG for our extra draw that we have. So of course, if you had played this differently, you could have potentially had, you know, GG played earlier and, you know, move around your board a little bit differently, but this is the type of play that maximizes the power gain from the crest best while still giving you that extra card draw and managing to, of course, use all of the effects to the best that you can. So I hope those examples help to illustrate how sequencing and compression are so important. I think compression is something that most Vanguard players know because, you know, if you compress your deck, you're likely to hit your triggers. But sequencing with compression is really important to think about, so I want you to really take that lesson home. Tip number four, read the hand. So what reading the hand means is essentially not just memorizing your opponent's drive checks, which I know can be both hard for some people and easy for others. It kind of depends on how good your memory ability is. But the standard format introduced a very interesting way of adding an additional dimension to reading the hand, which is through the ride deck. Now, you might not be thinking about this too much, but actually the ride deck gives you so much information information and is able to give you the ability to read so much about what your opponent has in hand that you might not be aware of. What I mean by this is, pay attention to what your opponent discards for the right deck and make assumptions of their hand based on that. So obviously you can analyze your own gameplay for this too, right? Where when you look at what you have to discard for your hand, let's say your hand is full of combo pieces and like a Persona Ride. You don't want to ditch the combo pieces because you need them for turn 3, and you don't want to ditch the Persona Ride because that's going to help you maybe win the game on turn 4. But you have one trigger in hand. And so you might be thinking, okay, I cannot lose any of these combo pieces, I cannot lose a Persona Ride, so I'm going to ditch the trigger. And so what ditching the trigger basically tells you is that chances are, let's say your opponent's doing that, your opponent probably has a lot of combo pieces that they cannot afford to lose in their hand, and so they're ditching these triggers. Now, let's say your opponent ditches their Persona Ride for the Ride deck, which does happen sometimes. There, you can infer that your opponent is bloated on grade 3s or shieldless cards in hand and needs to keep the few triggers they do have in hand. You can also kind of assume other things, right? If they're ditching specific combo parts that maybe they cannot get back in the late game, then that probably means they have some of the other cards that they need for earlier turns to play out and push damage as well. So you can make various kinds of assumptions based on what your opponent is discarding. Like sometimes your opponent will discard a Perfect Guard, and then you can also make the assumption, okay, they must have a lot of PGs in hand, and so if I start attacking them with lower pokes, then that's going to be harder for them to guard because all they have is PGs. So read the opponent's hand, make assumptions based on what they're discarding. Set 10 has made this a little bit harder actually by introducing the cycle cards that work off of being discarded for the right deck. So when your opponent discards one of these, it's like, well, that is the most optimal card to discard, so of course they're going to discard that. So there, it makes it a bit harder to make assumptions, but when they don't discard those, then you can really start thinking, what are they putting there? There's also some decks like Willista that soul charge from hand on their early turns, and you can definitely infer from that as well, right? So if they put a critical trigger or something to soul, then it's like, okay, I can make the same assumptions from that as I could from you discarding that variety deck. So keep that in mind and think about, you know, what your opponent reveals to you. It's not just drive checks, but it's really every little piece of information and what they search and how they compress that you can read from their hand. And the fifth tip, which I think is going to be the most easily applicable right now immediately, is use data. VG Paradox is literally your best friend. VG Paradox is a website, if you don't know, which is compiling all the tournament data from all over the world for Vanguard right now, and especially for standard format, it is so easy to take a look at deck lists from all over the world for every deck that you want to play that has any kind of competitive presence. Even for decks that you think are like off meta, like Leonor and Masks, you can find tops for those as well. Use the data, and especially because the Japanese events give you an early preview of what the English meta will be like as well, you can play test on things like CFA or with proxies and kind of try things out ahead of the competition as well, because you know that the BCS format will be a little bit different. It'll have some new releases as well, which are more fitting to what the Japanese meta is playing in. That being said, don't over focus on the Japanese data either, because there's also results from all over the world, right? You have the parts of Asia that play the Japanese format that might have different ideas, and you want to check those out as well. And of course, focus on results from like BCS and BSF as well that are coming from the English format, and also with your local environment too. If you have a BCS that is more close to where you live, then maybe the format that is more likely to be played in your locals is going to be seen there too. But just keep in mind that people are traveling from all over the country or all over the region in order to compete in these, so you really want to try to account for as much as possible and try to keep your testing as efficient as possible too. So use data, let it inform your playtesting as well as your deck building decisions. And whenever there's like tournament streams, there's not that many for Vanguard sadly, because Bushiro doesn't invest into the infrastructure as much as I keep complaining about it. But there are some events that are streamed. There was events from China that were streamed. There are sometimes videos from Japanese events, and lately there's been like Singapore and whatnot and Thailand being streamed, so check those out, try to find those kind of videos as well and just analyze people's plays. Otherwise, just interact with the top players as well. Some of the top players like Derek Dao and Men Long, they do coaching on Medify and stuff like that. I'm not like giving them a plug or anything, but I think that coaching is really efficient. I've taken coaching before as well in order to improve, and it's really, really helped a lot, so like I do recommend it. Not sponsored or anything, I'm just genuinely putting that out there. So I think coaching is kind of like part of data. It's like kind of the same, where it's like you are getting more information, more resources that you wouldn't otherwise have on your own. And I guess that takes me to my final kind of bonus tip. I know I already named five, but one final bonus tip is, this one is, I guess, like a bonus because I apply this to myself and it might not be applicable to everyone. And for me, when I'm playtesting and preparing for events, I prioritize lessons over wins. So after every single tournament match, when I go to locals, I try to take notes when I'm like actively playtesting. Sometimes I'm just like going to locals just to unwind and play, right? I don't want to go like super try hard and think about all my plays and overanalyze because it's tiring, you know, I don't want to clock clock out of work just to clock back in into testing sometimes. But when I am seriously preparing for an event, I always take notes and always write down what went wrong and what went badly as well, and like what went good, what was successful, what helped me push for a game. And most importantly, write down what you tried that worked or didn't work. So in my case, for example, I was playtesting with AoE very heavily, and then I was thinking, okay, the Willista matchup is really bad, but that's partially because I also don't have any early game in AoE, and it's really hard to block against their early game, especially going second. So I was like, let's try playing a bit more aggressively. What if I call down rears on turn two, even if they're just grade two obscurates and push, and then even if they swing in my rears and leave me with just one damage, does that mean that I'm actually that screwed, or can I navigate with that and just push the game to become longer and then win through that? That is not a situation I normally put myself into playing AoE, but I tried it out and then I, you know, went to see if it worked or not, and then I took notes on if it worked or not as well. So always take notes and always try to challenge your preconceptions, right? Don't settle for a game plan like just because somebody told you that the deck plays like this and you should always do the combos like this. Don't settle for that. Always challenge things and try things out yourself. Of course, there will be best examples, right? You know, you don't have to, you know, if you're playing Chrono Jet, don't go like swing both rears then use Fate Rider because you're losing out on so much power. But there might be certain little intricate moves, or especially early game moves, that might change how the game paces out. So do think about that. Do think about how you approach the game, and don't just go like right swing pass, and then start playing from turn three. And like for playtesting especially, I think that if you're actively playtesting with a friend and you're both preparing for an event seriously, playing with open hands is really, really useful. Because with open hands, you can actually talk through each other's plays. Like you can discuss as like, if I do this, how will you respond? If I go aggro here, will you guard? How would this attack pattern change how you would guard? And things like that. And also explore just doing plays you normally wouldn't to see what it would do. Because when you're playtesting with open hands and an open discussion, you're able to come to conclusions a lot easier than trying to figure out all in your head without knowing what your opponent's hand is too. Of course, don't like change your attack patterns just because you know how much shield is in your opponent's hand. You should still challenge it as if both hands are closed, but by having open hands, you're able to actually find solutions a lot easier, in my opinion. So that is it. Those are my tips. I hope this has been useful. If it was, please do like the video and let me know if any of these are helpful, which ones you would recommend yourself from your practice. And of course, if you haven't already, please do subscribe. I'm asking this every single video because I'm trying to reach 100k. Most importantly, I'd like to reach 55k before the summer ends. So if you could subscribe, that'd be super cool. And if you want to support my channel in any other way, you can become a YouTube channel member. I've been uploading bonus videos for YouTube channel members that are also going to be helping you improve too. So you definitely want to check those out if you're interested. You can click the join button below if you want to do that. And otherwise, check out my socials in the description below for all the other different things like my Twitch and my Instagram and everything and all that kind of stuff. Otherwise, that's going to be it for me today. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you guys next time. Bye-bye.